the last time we talked about turbulent flow in a tube and got a relation which describes heat transfer for a fluid with a Prandtl number equal to 1. Now what we want to do is today to see how we can get a relation for fluids with a Prandtl number different from 1. And I will make a sketch again of the tube. Actually, so that I have more space available, I will just use half the tube. So this is the center line of the tube. This would be the wall. And we imagine having a flow through the tube, which is turbulent, so that we have this mixing motion superimposed on the mean flow. We create a condition that the wall temperature is larger than the temperature in the fluid, so that we will have heat transfer from the tube wall into the fluid. Then, for instance, by a pitot tube, we measure the time averaged velocity in a cross section, so as a in function of the radius of the tube. And for turbulent flow, we know that we get a velocity profile which looks something like this. Then, if this indicates a wall, maybe we can indicate by arrows again, the way this figure is to be understood, that these are the velocities at the respective radial distances. Then we assume that the wall temperature has this value, so we plot temperatures again from this radial line, and the temperature then will drop and will have some represented by a curve like this. So these are again temperatures. This would be velocities, this would be temperatures. And then one more information which we need is the last time, and actually already in the preceding lecture, we talked about the turbulent diffusivity, which gives us information on how intense the momentum is transported by the turbulent movement relative to the laminar transport of momentum. And we found from measurement, from experiments, that the turbulent diffusivity is, again, if we plot it over the radial distance, given by a figure which has approximately this shape. It drops then near the wall down to a value 0. So this would be the epsilon value. We have also seen that this describes the transport of momentum, which then affects the velocity profile, determines the velocity profile. We also introduced a thermal diffusivity for the thermal transport, which determines the temperature profile and the radial transport of heat. We saw that the distribution of the epsilon T for the temperature is quite similar to the distribution of the epsilon for the flow. Now, in order to make in a simple way, a calculation for a Prandtl number different from 1, we will follow the derivation as it has been introduced by Ludwig Prandtl and G.I. Taylor, and he did the following. Yeah, maybe I can do one more thing. I will, in this one diagram, indicate also the kinematic viscosity, which determines as the laminar transport through shear of momentum from one fluid line into the other, and this might be it. And then we have discussed already that in the bulk of the fluid, the epsilon is much larger than the nu, so the turbulent transport is much larger than the laminar transport. But since the epsilon near at the wall drops down to the value 0, there will be a small region close to the wall where both are of equal magnitude. And this we will find is now important if the Prandtl number is different from 1. Now, instead of considering the actual shape of the diffusivity, for the analysis which we want to make, Ludwig Brandl, and we will follow him, made the following simplification. He said, I consider a certain layer in which the, instead of having both transport modes of the same magnitude, we assume in a simplified way that there will only be laminar transport. So in this layer, the epsilon will be zero. And then in the rest here, the epsilon will be large compared to the nu. So maybe I can indicate by another color the approximate shape. We assume that up to this layer, the epsilon, which determines the turbulent transport, is large compared to the nu, and then it drops suddenly down and is zero in this wall layer. And I mentioned that this wall layer is also called, or was originally called by Brandl, laminar sublayer. Today one prefers to call it viscous sublayer, because really the flow is not quite laminar in this region, as we see that in reality we still have an epsilon in this layer. Now, then we will do the following. Now, here we say in this layer we have only turbulent transport. So for this layer we can use the equations as we had derived them, connecting the turbulent heat flux to the turbulent shear. And we will also assume that Reynolds analogy applies, which again we have seen is quite a good approximation. This means really that the turbulent Brandl number is also equal to 1. And for this situation then, we found for this ratio, this is Cp times, minus actually, times dt over dv. At, let's say, the ratio of the heat flux to the shear in an arbitrary plane here, arbitrary surface, which we would put in here, is equal to the specific heat times a small variation in temperature, of the temperature in this region, divided by a small variation of the velocity over the same distance. Now, we have also seen the last time that if we have this situation that the turbulent transport alone is determining, that then in this layer the temperature profile must be similar to the velocity profile. Actually, what we have found the last time is that for a Brandl number equal to 1, the whole temperature profile is similar to the whole velocity profile. But with the same reasoning, now we can conclude that in the turbulent region, this means outside this laminar sublayer, there must be similarity. And then again, we can put any temperature variation and temperature distance, temperature difference over any distance in this layer in, and divide it by the corresponding velocity variation over the same distance. Now, what we will use is the following. For the temperature in the mainstream, we will use the bulk temperature as 1. Temperature, and correspondingly then we use here the mean velocity. And then I will indicate the velocity and the temperature at the border between the core flow, the turbulent core flow, and the viscous sublayer by a small index V. So if I draw now this border between the two layers also in here, then this is a velocity V sub B, lowercase b, so that we have a difference between this capital B here. And in the same way, the temperature here we call dt sub b. So that I can now continue writing this equation, and I will see that immediately I take, by taking the proper differences, take care of the minus sign. I will take t sub lowercase b minus t sub capital B. And now I just have to take the velocities at corresponding situations. Now to the t sub b belongs the velocity v sub b, and to the t sub capital B belongs the velocity v sub m. But in order to get rid of the minus sign, I turn this difference around. I have v sub m minus v sub lowercase b. So, and this relation then is the one which we use in the turbulent core. Now, then we go to the sublayer. And in the sublayer we said that we neglect the effect of turbulence completely. So here, transport is only caused by laminar action. Heat transport by conduction, momentum transport by the laminar shear. So we use the corresponding equations for laminar transport. And we found for this the last time minus C sub P times alpha over nu. Just to recall, specific heat times thermal diffusivity divided by the kinematic viscosity times the corresponding temperature difference divided by the velocity difference again. So really this is a factor which makes the laminar transport now different from the turbulent transport. And we know that the ratio nu over alpha is the laminar Prandtl number, the Prandtl number which is a property of the fluid with which we have to deal. So we can also continue and write this, and maybe we can do two steps at the same time, C sub P divided by Prandtl number. And now again we use introduced temperature difference and velocities, since here again for the laminar situation similarity must exist between corresponding points. So as we did before, we will now use the difference between the wall temperature and the bulk temperature. Excuse me, not bulk temperature, but this borderline temperature. And the corresponding velocity difference is 0 minus V sub B. And in order to get the V sub P, the minus sign away, we just have to write V sub P. Actually, one step which we, which I should have introduced at this point already, which we have pointed out the last time, that in this analysis we also assume that the ratio Q over tau in our field here is independent of the radial location and is therefore the same ratio as the ratio at the wall. So we can then here write this is equal to Q, the heat flux from the wall surface into the fluid, to the shear stress which the fluid exerts on the wall surface. And this also is equal to Q sub wall over tau sub. And now we have essentially the following situation, that we have heat transfer under the action of two resistances to the transfer in series. First, we have to overcome the resistance to the heat flux in the viscous sublayer, and then we have an additional resistance to transport now the heat into the bulk of the fluid. And this is described by these two equations. And always, if we have resistances in series, we somehow try to add them up so that we get the total resistance. What we want to do is again to eliminate here the teeth and the temperature at the borderline, because this is very difficult to measure. So we will do this by solving both equations for the temperature difference and then adding the equations up. If we do this on the first equation, we get T sub B minus T sub capital B is equal to Q wall over C sub P tau wall and multiplied by the corresponding velocity difference, V sub M minus V sub B. And then we go to the second equation and solve it. T wall minus T lowercase b is equal to Prandtl over C sub P times Q wall over tau wall times V sub B. And then by adding up both equations, we eliminate again the borderline temperature. We get wall temperature minus bulk temperature. This mixed mean temperature in the fluid is equal to Q wall over C sub P tau wall. And let's do this, let me also bracket out the Vm. And then from here we have, since we took the Vm out, we have just one. Then if I take this as a next term, we have to add these three terms here. If I take this as a next term, I maintain the Prandtl number and the V sub P. And then here I have the V sub P alone, so I will take the V sub P out. And since I have the V sub M taken out, I have to write 1 over V sub M in here, times, and then there's a Prandtl number from here, and 1 from here. Now, as always, it is of advantage to introduce a heat transfer coefficient by a equation which defines the heat transfer coefficient, and we use, as always, for tube flow, as we have done before, the equation that the heat flow is equal to a heat transfer coefficient times a temperature difference. And it is just this temperature difference which is used to define for tube flow a heat transfer coefficient. And then you see, if I introduce here the Q sub wall through this equation, then this temperature difference drops out on both sides of the equation. And then let's solve the equation immediately for the heat transfer coefficient alone. And we get the heat transfer coefficient. And then I have to bring this over to the other side. Is C sub P tau wall divided by Vm, V sub M, and then this comes in the denominator. And this is the equation which, for instance, as I mentioned, Ludwig Prandtl and G.I. Taylor at approximately the same time independently obtained. Now, one thing which we can check immediately, whether our calculation is correct, we can check back. We have before, in the last lecture, made a calculation for Prandtl number equal to 1. And of course, this should really agree with the last calculation if the Prandtl number is equal to 1. Well, if Prandtl number is equal to 1, this term in the bracket is equal to 0. This means the whole denominator is equal to 1. And if you check back in the notes, we had exactly the same. Heat transfer coefficient is C sub P times tau wall over Vm, found the last time. Now, this means actually the equation we had then the last time replaced the shear at the wall by a friction factor, and in this way obtained an equation for the Nusselt number. This we can do here in the same way. The only additional thing which we need is now for our calculations the ratio of the velocity at the borderline of the viscous sublayer to the mean velocity. And this is of course somewhat a artificial thing because we introduce this sharp separating surface between the sublayer and the mean flow just through this simplified picture of the way how the turbulent diffusivity varies. So the only way to get really to an expression for this ratio is to compare then this equation with experiment and from experiment to see, well, under what conditions for which expression of this V sub B over V sub M do I get agreement. And it was found that if one introduces this ratio as V sub M over V sub B equal to 1.5 times Reynolds Prandtl to the power minus 1/8. That then one gets agreement. And in this way then, now first introducing this velocity ratio here into the denominator, and then for the term in the numerator, the corresponding term which we found the last time for Prandtl number equal to 1, one gets to the final equation. And this is the following. The Nusselt number, and the Nusselt number is defined as heat transfer coefficient multiplied with the diameter of the tube divided by the thermal conductivity of the fluid is equal to .0395 times Reynolds to the power 3/4 times Prandtl, and then divided by 1 plus 1.5. Now this ratio comes in times Reynolds Prandtl minus 1/8 times Prandtl minus 1. And this equation is found to reproduce experiments which have been performed quite well, except if the Prandtl number becomes very large. Let's say for very viscous oil, experiments, the equation doesn't agree very well. And then one had to try to improve the analysis. Now, I mentioned already before that much work really by many scientists has been put into the effort to try to improve on this, mainly by getting rid or refining this assumption which we have made here, replacing actually this sharp break in the epsilon values by a more gradual one. The calculation gets, if one does this, more and more complicated, but then the results which one gets become more generally valid in the way that they also hold for larger Prandtl numbers. Yeah, and with this I think I would like to conclude the discussion of turbulent heat transfer in a tube. Now, as in laminar flow, we should also talk about turbulent flow, external flow. And as an example, we will look again at turbulent flow, a turbulent boundary layer caused by a flow over a flat plate with a velocity, let's say V0, in the upstream and in the mainstream, and a temperature T0. Then we know that this flow if it moves over a plate which is at rest, creates a boundary layer, which at first is laminar, but then at a certain distance, which is described by a critical Reynolds number, becomes turbulent. So this is now the turbulent part. And measurements have shown that the temperature profiles, the velocity profiles, which exist in the turbulent part of the boundary layer, are quite similar in shape to the profiles which one measures in a tube. So that one can conclude, and again, Prandtl was the first one to do this, to say, well, then obviously I can really go through the same analysis in principle as here. I will end up with the same result, but I can even do it simpler. I can say, well, these equations should hold for a boundary layer as well as for tube flow if I use the proper dimensions. This means we can consider the tube flow, as we have seen, as two boundary layers which have grown until they have met in the center line, so that the radius of the tube would correspond to the thickness of the boundary layer. So we would introduce, instead of the radius of the tube, the thickness of the boundary layer. And then, the temperature T0, or let's say the bulk temperature, we would replace by the temperature T0. And correspondingly, the mean velocity in tube flow by the velocity outside of the boundary layer. Actually, one should probably have more exactly introduced for the center line velocity, the V0, the velocity outside of the boundary layer, and the same for the temperature. But the difference is not very large if one changes the relations in this way. And then, if one does this, one can get a relation for the Nusselt number, which is quite similar to this one here. Actually, one still has to go through an analysis, because generally one doesn't know the boundary layer thickness. So one then, by some force balance applied to the boundary layer, one has to calculate the boundary layer thickness, and introduces then in such an equation, let's say a parameter which one has to know is, at what distance from the leading edge of the plate am I interested to determine the heat transfer coefficient? And a relation which is obtained in this way is the following. So this is for tube flow. Which is quite similar in shape, only the constant and the exponent vary somewhat. 0.0297 times Reynolds, and to the power 4/5 times Prandtl, divided by 1 plus 1.3 Reynolds to the minus 1/10 Prandtl to the minus 1/8 times Prandtl minus 1. And this would be for flow, external flow over a flat plate, so that the flow generates a turbulent boundary layer. Now again, for the flat plate, in the same way as for the tube flow, one can refine the analysis and get some slight variations of the equation. Usually the equations get somewhat more complicated. Another procedure which is often used in this connection is just to rely on experiments and to start out with the knowledge that for forced flow of a fluid with constant properties, or in praxis with properties which don't vary too much with temperature, one knows that one has to obtain an equation of the form Nusselt is a function of Reynolds number and Prandtl number. We saw actually always in our calculation that always these same parameters appear. And one finds quite often that if one makes experiments over a constricted range, that one can approximate now the experiments by a specific form of this equation. Nusselt number is equal to a constant times the Reynolds number to a certain power, let's say A, times the Prandtl number to another power, let's say B. But one shouldn't expect that such a form of an equation always holds. This is often in, let's say, especially in more practical engineering books, this statement is found that one must get an equation of this form. That is not true at all. Only for certain situations often one can approximate this function by this equation. Maybe it would be good we have now quite some results for tube flow, for external flow over a flat plate to see in a diagram. How do we expect this relationship to look qualitatively? But maybe before, I think before I go this, I would like to treat once more another situation. We have, a characteristic different situation occurs when we find something which we call a flow separation. And we know that such a flow separation always occurs if we have a step, for instance, in a surface contour. If we would have a flow moving along here, there might be a boundary layer which has developed in this flow. And this viscous flow in the boundary layer now arrives suddenly at the corner. Then in the lecture on fluid mechanics we have discussed that at reasonable Reynolds numbers we find that always separation of the flow occurs in the sense that this viscous layer now separates from the surface and creates something which is called, referred to as a free boundary layer or free shear layer. This layer finally again attaches to the surface and then moves on here. And this layer separates the external flow, which then moves along in this way by drawing streamlines, from the flow in here, which is essentially rotating in nature. So the viscous forces tend to take the fluid particles here in the neighborhood of the shear layer along, and these fluid particles then, let's say, the flow returns and circulates. Now, in detail, how this flow appears, this is now separated flow. and how it affects heat transfer to these surfaces now here depends quite characteristically on the Reynolds number, as always. The Reynolds number is found a parameter. If the Reynolds number is small enough, and maybe I should mention one more thing. Now, if we talk about the separated flow situation, we come into a situation which is still not too well basically understood. So I think we have a fairly good qualitative picture of what happens, but as far as quantitative information is concerned, one has to rely almost completely on experiments. There is no analysis as yet available which would give really good results. So that what we want to discuss here mainly is in a qualitative way how heat transfer will occur under such situations. And as a preliminary to this, we again have to see what kind of flow situations do we have. Now, if we start out with a lower Reynolds number and then gradually increase the Reynolds number, we will find the following, that at sufficiently low Reynolds number, the flow in this whole field is laminar. This means out here we have very nice fluid particles which move in a straight orderly way side by side. The flow in the shear layer is also laminar. There are no velocity fluctuations. And this is in a very steady way turning around, but steady, no turbulence. If we talk about turbulence, the characteristic of turbulent flow that it's time varying and that it is an irregular movement. Then if we increase now gradually the Reynolds number, we find that the flow starts somewhere at first in larger distance from the point where it has separated in the viscous layer to kind of wiggle, to become wavy. Then these waves break up into vortices, first regular vortices, which then again break up into smaller vortices and then go into this statistical irregular turbulence. Again, where this occurs, this transition to turbulence, as I have it described, occurs, depends again on a Reynolds number. Now, if one introduces as a length parameter in the Reynolds number the distance from the point of separation, and as a characteristic velocity, the velocity in the main flow outside of the shear layer and of the separating flow, let's say the velocity here, we'll call V0, then the Reynolds number will be the velocity V0 multiplied with this characteristic length divided by the kinematic viscosity. One finds that it is of order of magnitude, but even this has not been too well established today, really about 10,000. It appears that it also depends, and one would expect probably that it depends also on how thick this boundary layer is as it approaches here, for instance, compared to the height of this step, in addition to the Reynolds number. But this hasn't been really very clearly investigated yet. This means then, from this equation, we can calculate at what length the laminar shear layer breaks up in a turbulent one. And of course, the larger the Reynolds number, the Reynolds number is a constant. The larger velocity, the smaller the length of the laminar portion of the shear layer. So with increasing, if we would make an experiment with increasing velocity, this would gradually reduce. And finally, we will come again to a situation where the main part of the shear layer is turbulent. But in all of these, the flow in the separated region would still be in a, circulating in a more or less regular way. But then if we increase the Reynolds number sufficiently to a sufficiently high value, now, not this Reynolds number, but let's say the Reynolds number, for instance, based on a characteristic length in the geometry which is given.
For instance, based on the height, on the step height.
Yes. Then we will find that the following thing happens. Now this vortex which runs around here is carried away with the fluid, and then this shear layer comes much closer, starts now building up a new vortex. When this vortex has grown large enough, the vortex is moved away in the fluid. The shear layer again builds up a new vortex, and this repeats itself, so that we have now also, in addition to this small time, the turbulent fluctuation, we have this fluctuation that this separated region is periodically emptied and refilled with a much larger time constant. Now, what effect do these various situations have on heat transfer? As long as the flow completely is laminar, if the shear layer is laminar also, we have the following, that actually always on a wall we have a boundary layer. So this circulating flow really builds again along the wall here a new boundary layer. And this means if we are interested in the heat transfer over this surface or over this surface, we have a resistance to the heat transfer in this shear layer, and we have another resistance to the heat transfer in this shear layer. Whereas if we wouldn't have the step, for instance here at this place, we have just one resistance in one shear layer. So we expect, and this is found by experiment, that the heat transfer is smaller here as it would be if we would just have extended the surface without a step. On this location here, we can expect always to have a large heat transfer coefficient, because here this jet moves against the wall and causes this way a sweeping of the surface, and in this way a comparatively large heat transfer coefficient. If the flow becomes turbulent, then the resistance in this turbulent layer becomes quite small. Here the shear layer is turbulent, so the heat transfer becomes quite large and comparable to the heat transfer which we would have on a flat plate. Here the heat transfer at the, one calls this the reattachment point, is again quite large. And finally, if we get these fluctuating flows, this emptying and refilling, then since continuously by this process, continuously new fluid is brought into the cavity, then the heat transfer becomes very large and can be considerably larger than the heat transfer which we would have if we would have no step in the contour. direction as here. Again, we would find that the flow separates, that we have again here this rotating flow, same thing here. And qualitatively, it's the same thing which we have discussed on this sudden surface contour in outward flow, we would also have in channel flow. Now, this not only causes, let's say, if there is turbulence, conditions of high heat transfer, but it causes quite a large pressure drop also, such a sudden increase in cross section. And one often tries to avoid this separation here by increasing the cross section of the channel only gradually. So one would have then a channel like this. Now, one finds that if one wants to avoid separation, so to have a flow which really follows along the walls, that one has to make this increase quite gradual as a kind of rule, but again, this is quite complicated and depends on specific situations, but a first order rule would be that, let's say, this height should be not more than about one-tenth of this distance. If one exceeds this, then one finds again that one gets local separation. The situation may even be worse, in the way that often then the flow decides to separate just on one side and then reattach again, whereas it stays reattached on the other side. But then the situation may, caused by some very small disturbance, suddenly change, the separation might jump over to the other side, and this causes then a very unstable situation in the flow. The flow again fluctuates, which of course has the influence which we discussed on heat transfer. In addition, if one wants to, for instance, use this in an experiment, one couldn't get to steady situation, flow situation in the experiment at all. So often, if one is not too concerned with pressure drops, the pressure drop is in general smaller here than in this situation. But the advantage here is that the flow knows exactly he has to separate here, which causes a much more stable situation than here, where the flow, so to speak, selects his place where it separates. So if one wants to have steady flow, then often one prefers actually this situation against the one which I have shown up there. Another situation which causes to flow separation in a duct is if I go through a bend. If I have a bend like this, for instance, in a tube. Now, in principle, I will have the following situation. Here, let's say I would have first a straight section. Here, the pressure is uniform over the tube, because the streamlines are straight as they approach here. Now here then, the streamlines have to go through a curve, and this means there will be centrifugal forces acting on the fluid particles, and to counteract these centrifugal forces and to force the flow around the bend, there has to be a pressure which is larger in the outer region and drops towards the center. So we will always have a larger pressure here, a smaller pressure here, and this means that since the pressure was uniform here, we will find that the pressure at first increases along the outer wall. And always, when a pressure increases, like here, where we have again, if the flow stays, is not separating, then as the cross section increases, the velocity slows down, and this means, according to Bernoulli's equation, that the pressure must increase. And always where we have a situation where the pressure increases and where we have a boundary layer, say some viscous region near a surface, then this viscous region has a tendency to separate. Here again, we have a pressure increase in this direction, and a consequence we find that if the bend is sharp enough, we will have separation here. Now, on the inner wall, the pressure will drop from here to here because we said the pressure is large here, pressure is small here, whereas here it was uniform. So here there is no danger of separation. But then going back into the straight line, finally the pressure will be again uniform over the cross section. So from this smaller pressure, the pressure has to rise along the wall to this uniform pressure, and then there is the danger of separation on this side here. This, of course, depends again on Reynolds numbers. The danger of the separation would be small at very low Reynolds numbers. At larger Reynolds numbers, it becomes larger. One more consequence or a thing which occurs in flow around a bend is the following. If I draw a cross-section through here, and I will draw it here. This would be a circular cross-section. And let's say this would be the outer side, this would be the outer side, this is inner, the inner side. Then I have the following situation. We know that, for instance, from this flow, that near the wall we have always a region with small velocities, whereas in the core we have the larger velocities. So here we would have around the wall. Of course, it is not just a separate region, but in general, near the wall, the velocities will be small. In the core, they will be large. Now, we will have the following situation. If we look at a fluid particle here, as the flow now moves around the bend, the velocity is here quite large, is maximum largest. Therefore, the centrifugal force is very large. The centrifugal force is proportional to the square of the velocity. So here we will have a large centrifugal force. Out here, the velocity is much smaller. Therefore, the centrifugal force is much smaller. Now again, in order to balance the situation, this large centrifugal force had to be balanced by a large pressure increase in this direction. Let's say the pressure, there must be a pressure drop from the outside towards the inside to force the flow around the bend. This will be large here, smaller here. So as a consequence, we will have the situation that now the fluid in the outer portion moves towards the inside, and then it moves back here on the outside, forced by the centrifugal forces. So we get a so-called secondary flow in this way. And this then is superimposed. So instead of having a nice straight line, we will have two kind of spiraling, the fluid spiraling around as it moves down around the bend. And this, of course, if the centrifugal forces, if this secondary flow is large enough, will again influence heat transfer. Again, this is a situation which is, of course, much more difficult analytically to investigate, so one will mainly rely on experiments to get information on this situation, and results are available in the literature. I just want to discuss one more situation of external flow, and this is flow around a sphere, or let's say a cylinder better, in cross flow. If I have a cylinder in a fluid which moves in this direction, then one finds again that the flow situation, and the flow situation determines heat transfer, is strongly dependent on Reynolds number. If we start with very small Reynolds number in this case would be formed in the way that we multiply the upstream velocity with the diameter of the cylinder and divide it by the kinematic viscosity. If the Reynolds number is small enough, we find that if we follow a streamline, it moves around the surface of the cylinder and moves off here. The next streamline here would go around in this way. And the next streamline would go around in this way and so on. And the same thing on the lower side. This might be the flow situation if the Reynolds number is smaller than 1. If we then gradually increase the Reynolds number, we find that, if we draw again the cylinder, that the flow starts separating somewhere. You see again, what we can predict immediately from just from this qualitative picture is how does the pressure vary along the circumference of such a cylinder. From continuity, we know that the same volume of fluid must flow through any cross-section within such a stream tube. So this means cross-sectional area times velocity has to be constant. Where the cross-sectional area is large, the velocity will be small. So here the velocity will increase, but then here it decreases again. And Bernoulli's equation tells us that where the velocity increases, then pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy, so the pressure drops. On the other hand, here in the back, kinetic energy is reconverted into pressure energy, pressure increases. And always at sufficiently large Reynolds numbers, in regions where the pressure increases, there's a danger of flow separation. And this, if the Reynolds number is larger than 1, I think, let's say, around 20, we will find that the flow has separated. But still, in a nice, orderly, laminar fashion, we get a so-called separation bubble back here. Maybe I should use again color. A streamline would come here, would go around here, would continue here, and would move off here. And then the next streamline here would run this way, and another one here, and the same thing in the lower half. And then in this separation bubble itself, we get again a rotating, actually two vortices, one here and another one moving around here. Now, as the Reynolds number gets larger and larger, then this point of separation gradually moves upstream, the separation bubble gets larger. And this goes on for some time, until when the Reynolds number gets in the region of about 100, then again something else happens. That these vortices which are here are now intermittently carried away by the fluid, and they are carried away in an alternate way. So there would be first maybe the upper vortex would move away, and then the lower vortex would move away, and they are carried away in the fluid in this way. The streamlines outside of this configuration would again move along here. So that would be for Reynolds numbers larger than 100. And this, of course, is again, let's say, actually, in principle, these various situations are the same as we had it here. We have at first a very laminar, steady flow with the separation bubble here, and then I mentioned this intermittency here, it's sufficiently large Reynolds number, same thing happens here. And again, the effect is so that the whole flow has becomes unstable, becomes fluctuating. For instance, it acts back on the force on the cylinder. This force on the cylinder would fluctuate too as the vortex moves off actually a very famous incident was explained in this way. You may have heard about the collapse of the Tacoma Bridge in the state of Washington, a bridge which then under certain wind velocities started to wiggle, and finally the fluctuations become so large that the bridge broke down. It was found that this is really an effect of this vortex shedding. The flow over the bridge caused this, was not quite a cylinder, but a body similar to this, caused these vortex to shed, and this shedding then caused the movement, and this came into resonance, and at a certain velocity caused the collapse of the bridge. Again, in experiments, one would avoid probably such a situation. And the effect on heat transfer would be, again, in a qualitative way, similar to this one. We would expect here, for instance, yeah, maybe it would be interesting to draw in here also the extent of the boundary layer. We would again have a boundary layer which for small Reynolds numbers becomes quite large. If you check back on the relations which we obtained for the thickness of the boundary layer on a flat plate, one finds that the smaller the Reynolds number, the larger the boundary layer. So we might have here a boundary layer, something like this, around, with, let's say, this limit. So this would give the thickness of the boundary layer. As the boundary layer gets thicker, since the heat transfer into the boundary layer is essentially by conduction, one can compare it roughly with heat transfer through a wall. The thicker a slab, the smaller the heat transfer, let's say, the more difficult it is to transport the heat through, the smaller the heat transfer coefficient. Here also, the heat transfer coefficient would be largest here, would drop off. Here, as long as this is laminar again, we would expect small heat transfer coefficient in the back. But if we get then to this situation, we can expect that the heat transfer in this separated region in the back of the cylinder is quite large. Yeah, I think at this point we should close for today.